Oceanographers rely upon scientific data to understand the material state of an ocean. In the documentary Mission Blue, marine scientist Sylvia Earle states that she believes in the science, what she sees in the water. And what she sees is a dying ocean. When based in science, attempts to solve environmental problems often focus on instrumental solutions. While useful, this logic can be co-opted by those who have no interest in restoring the ocean, epitomized by Rex Tillerson, Secretary of State and former ExxonMobil CEO, who argues that climate change is an engineering problem and has engineering solutions. However, as environmental lawyer and advocate Gus Speth has realized, the top environmental problems are selfishness, greed, and apathy, requiring a humanities approach that scientists and engineers are not trained to develop. In Mission Blue, we see Earle's upbringing in Dunedin, Florida, where she was always at play in the sea. So while she believes in the science, she also developed an effective relationship with the ocean, sensations which drive her scientific work but can't be easily expressed to others. I also grew up on the water, and like many, I'm not trained to understand science as Earle does. But while she can read scientific reports and produce scientific research, she's not trained to tell us how the ocean feels. As Speth surmises, to deal with these problems, we need a cultural and spiritual transformation. And we scientists don't know how to do that. I'm not sure anyone does, but perhaps we can begin by thinking about the ocean in a different way. I want to know how to feel like an ocean, something so vastly huge, sublime, and difficult to define, that it may be impossible, at least using typical methods. Gregory L. Ulmer argues that new media writing technologies provide a new method of writing, one that's based more on effective judgment than literate, conceptual, instrumental logic. One method for writing such relationships is the puncept, which uses the logic of the joke, but also the proportional analogy to structure and understand effective relationships. How is X in its situation analogous to Y? In this case, how am I, in my situation, analogous to the ocean? Where do we intersect? How is our relationship structured? How to create a proportional analogy with the ocean? I'm going to start where I grew up, in the Florida Keys, a liminal space between land and water. And I'm going to start with an icon from this place that may not seem oceanic, the key lime pie. The key lime pie is from the earth, but could only come into being because of the sea. Before there were bridges or refrigeration in Key West, there was also no ice. Like many other remote places, food spoiled quickly, but this was especially true for fishermen at sea. When Gale Borden Jr. began condensing milk in the U.S. in 1853, it became an instant hit in places like the Keys and found its way onto boats, along with other less perishable foods, such as eggs and fruit. One day, probably a sponger, put together eggs, key limes, and condensed milk, foods which typically don't taste that great on their own, and came up with the key lime pie, a concoction which cooked from the chemical reaction between the milk and the lime juice. On these sponging boats, the key lime pie was most likely born at sea, an invention not due to necessity, but taste, pleasure. Where does this desire for taste lead us? If we think of the key lime pie as a mode of reasoning, can the puncept of pie offer clues to how the ocean feels? Based on its use in recent media productions, the key lime pie leads us to some very morbid sensations. In the film short Key Lime Pie by Trevor Jimenez, a man named Mitch Bernstein sits in a diner, narrating that the only thing that satisfies his unspecified itch is key lime pie. A piece of pie appears before him. We then see a noir version of the Grim Reaper across the table, ready to cut him down if he should eat the pie. This strange connection between key lime pie and death is then explained, as the man has eaten so many slices that his doctor warned him that another will turn his heart into a piece of pie and he'll die from the overdose. In the end, the man cannot resist, takes a bite, and dies. In an episode of the Miami-based television show Dexter, which depicts a sociopathic, homicidal, blood splatter technician who takes out his desire to kill on other serial killers, the records keeper Camilla has been searching her whole life for the perfect key lime pie. Laying in the hospital with fatal cancer, Camilla asks Dexter to help her find the perfect pie as her dying wish. When doctors tell her she will live a month longer than expected, Camilla finds this news horrifying, given her pain, and asks Dexter to assist her suicide. In the final pie, he brings a bit more than filling, injecting into it sodium pentothal and pancuronium. He feeds the pie to her, which he describes as perfect, killing her moments later. Key lime pie provides another transition between life and death. In the opening scene of Natural Born Killers, directed by Oliver Stone, we see the character Mickey Knox asking about the diner's pies, eventually settling on the key lime pie.
Well, key lime's great, but it's an acquired taste.
Well, I ain't had a key lime pie in 10 years.
When you had it, did you like it?
No, but that don't mean much. I was a completely different person back then. Let's give that key lime pie a day in court and a big old glass of non-fat milk, if you please.
As Mickey eats his pie, he watches his partner Mallory beat up a local who begins to lewdly dance with her in the restaurant. Ultimately, the two kill all of the others in the diner, except one bystander, whom they let live to tell the police what he saw. In Heartburn, based on Nora Ephron's novel, the pie enters the story to signal a death. Most of the story's plot depicts the imperfect marriage between the story's protagonist Rachel and her husband Mark, who has been having an affair. During a dinner party at their friend's house, Rachel opines about the changes a relationship goes through over time, sometimes changing so imperceptibly that one only notices the differences after it has morphed to become an unrecognizable dream. During this monologue, she realizes that their marriage is dead, which she punctuates by getting up from the table and smashing Mark in the face with the key lime pie that she made for the party. What does pieing signify? Pieing finds its origins in slapstick comedy and first appears in silent films in the 1910s. The first pieing appears in Mr. Flip, with one of the first epic pie fights in the 1913 film A Noise from the Deep. As Moira Marsh writes, pieing is often aimed at those in power, typically the pompous and the self-righteous. Pomposity is self-ignorance, a trait that is humorous in itself, but that also calls for ridicule and correction by means of a prank. When targets still cannot see themselves objectively after their pieing, the pranksters are vindicated. Self-ignorance violates Socrates' edict to know thyself, a state that is not always funny, but often tragic, as revealed to Oedipus. Marsh explains that public pieing is a ludic attack on authority, a highly visible ritual reversal of the normal distribution of power. Or, as a blogger explains, the VIP covered in cream, spluttering and sticky, briefly out of control, is suddenly no longer any different from us. He is removed from the rarefied air of beings who matter more than we do, and becomes human again. Just another schlub with pie on his face. Environmental activists often use pieing to bring attention to environmental issues, such as when PETA pied Canadian Fisheries Minister Gail Shea. Should I be pied? I am married to the ocean, or at least I'm in a relationship with it. Am I Rachel, or am I Mark? Am I Dexter, or Camilla? Am I Mickey, or everyone else at the diner? Does that matter? Am I dreaming? Do I dream that I am in a sustainable relationship with the ocean while really cheating on it, poisoning it with my daily choices? Those that are imperceptible while I am so far removed from it. I want a relationship that is pure, innocent, and mutually beneficial. But is this relationship dead? If I may riff off the title from a famous author who lived in Key West, for whom does the pie toll? Why has the key lime pie become associated with death in this way? How has it become a food from the underworld? If we take seriously my question's pun, based on Hemingway's title, based on John Donne's meditation, we know the answer is thee and me. The ocean, through the key lime pie, gives me four lessons for how we feel together. One, gluttonously consumed. Two, poisoned and in pain. Three, murdered. And four, betrayed. While certainly the ocean is in many ways a much more powerful force than humans, the Anthropocene tells us that we still affect it, and in more viral, microscopic, and insidious ways. In this effective reading, the ocean has pied me with a key lime pie to speak truth to power, that I have wronged it, to express how it feels. I cannot have key lime pie without the ocean, nor all that I love associated with my home in the Keys. And as Ulmer notes, it was the effective sensations of taste, of pleasure, of the spice trade that spurred the greed that got us into this mess and keeps us in this mess. Or as coral reef scientist Jeremy Jackson states,
in the final analysis, the really thing we really need to fix is ourselves. It's not about the fish. It's not about the pollution. It's not about the climate change. It's about us and our greed and our need for growth and our inability to imagine a world which is different from the selfish world we live in today.
Ultimately, I haven't really shown what the ocean feels, but how I should feel about it. And this has produced self-knowledge. I needed a pie in the face to know that the innocent relationship I had with the ocean as a kid is dead. Now, can I change and create a better one before I get pied again?
Ocean breeze, tire swing, coconut fall if you shake that thing, and my, key lime pie.